this one here locks in place, so it doesn't.
Welcome to the Nashua Historical Society. I'm Mary Kirkwood, and I will guide you through a little bit of this evening. We have Dave Smith with us tonight, and he's going to take us on a fantastic journey through the White Mountains. And we're all going to relax just before the holidays and feel really good that we're here in cold New Hampshire and enjoy our evening before we have to whip up some of those gorgeous meals and wrap those presents. So tonight, it's ours to just sit back and relax. Before we get started, there are just a few things. We certainly would like to invite you to browse the museum. The Ingalls exhibit just opened here last month, and that's certainly available to you this evening. We'd love to have you visit it if you haven't already. If you are not members, and I am seeing some new faces, certainly memberships are always welcome here at the Historical Society, and our curator, Beth, and our president, Bill Ross, are here, and they would love to talk to you about membership. So, a couple of things that a couple of our members are very excited about. We have the holiday tour coming up, and I'm going to purchase my ticket tonight. It's right here from this lovely lady, in case any of you are interested in the holiday tour. I know some of the singers at one of the venues. I'm very excited about that. And also, our very own Cal Knickerbocker has his presentation at the library coming up on the 18th. So we can all get out again and support Cal and wacky songs that made us laugh. How funny?
Very funny.
Very funny. Not just a little funny, but after you've had this beautiful, peaceful night, you can go and laugh with Cal on Thursday at the library. This would be good, too. Now, what else? Anything else? Did I miss anything, Beth?
No.
Tour?
Okay. Just that the house tour is the first weekend in December.
House tour is the first
Saturday and Sunday, first weekend in December.
Did they change that?
No, it's always the first weekend in December.
Always the first weekend. Yeah. So we.
I have some cards.
Your cards?
Oh,
she has tickets.
I have some of the cards. Maybe that's a reminder card.
We want a reminder. It's a beautiful opportunity to go browse around Nashville, poking all the pretty places. We were on this tour last year, our beautiful home.
Yes.
So that was certainly a highlight for us.
And City Hall is this year.
Yes, the rotunda. With beautiful music, I happen to know. So, tonight, without further ado, we'll get going on our trip through the White Mountains. We're going to talk about some popular stories.
Mm-hmm.
I'm so excited. Are they scary?
No, I don't do scary stuff. I get scared myself to talk about scary stories.
And we're going to pass this right on to Dave. Thank you
for
coming.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. My name is Dave Smith. Thank you, Mary. I want to thank the National Historical Society, Mary, and the other members of the organization for having me here. This is my first time in this area. Most of my shows are done up in the White Mountains to the Appalachian Mountain Club, which I'm a member at the Highland Center or at the Pinkham Notch, if you're familiar with those areas up there. I've done the Nashua Library, Hudson Library, and I'm going to be doing the Londonderry Library in January, so it's going to be the same show. So if you missed something tonight, come see me. A little bit about myself. I started photography back in 1972 or 71, and I enjoyed taking photography, and that was the film world. Everybody took their little cameras with film and took pictures. Well, as time went on, the digital world came in, so I started getting into digital. And using all my techniques and all my knowledge in photography with classes and everything, I brought it to the digital world, which is much easier to do in presentations. I do have a lot of slides that I took that are done. I used to do presentations with them, but not anymore. I'm going to try to bring them into the digital world. And I think everybody has a digital camera out there. Those that don't have a digital camera, raise your hand. Ah, you don't have one. I always get that one. Yeah. No, digital cameras are very popular now. They're being used a lot, and people are taking a lot of pictures of their families and sending them through emails and putting them, posting them out on Facebook and stuff like that, which is really good. And it's taken us photographers right down, you know. We don't usually do as much as we used to do, like weddings and activities, because a lot of people are doing them with their own cameras. But that's okay. A lot of times people don't do what I do. I climb the White Mountains of New Hampshire year-round and take pictures of in the fall, winter, spring, summer, and whatever. I just love going up there, and you'll see that in my show tonight. What I'll do is the first part is history of the White Mountains. We're going to cover three main events that took place up there. How Shakora became Shakora, the mountain. And we're going to talk about Darby Field, who was the first to climb Mount Washington. And we're going to also cover the Willie family, who's lived in the Crawford Notch. I think some people know about the Willie family. And I'm going to give you I'm going to give you an Indian name. I'm going to tell you an Indian name tonight before the show, and at the end of the show, I'll see if anybody knows what it is. Mm-hmm. It's called Agio Kukuchuk. Does anybody know what that stands for? No, good, because then I got no way to can jump back. But anyways, with further ado, we're going to go into the show, okay? Let me get this going here. This is not my equipment, but it's easy to work. The first one we're going to talk about is the legend of Shakora, which is Mount Shakora, which is the that's the most photographed mountain in the White Mountains, and painted mountain in the White Mountains too as well. And it takes place, it's in Shakora Village, which is just below Albany, around 16 Route 25. It's in the Sandwich Range. And that's it from one end of the trail. That's going up the Liberty Trail, which is the south side of the mountain. How many of you have ever climbed Mount Shakora? Okay, so you know what it is. Yeah, I've been up it from all different angles. I've even stayed at the Jim Liberty Cabin, if you know where that is, a number of nights years ago. But the story with Shakora was he was in a tribe that lived in the valley, and one time the tribe decided to go back to Canada because of the war that was going on. They wanted to go back up to Canada, but he stayed behind with his son, and he was very good friends with the family called the Cornelius Campbell family. And one time Chief Shakora decided he was going to go back up to Canada to visit his tribe. He left his child with the Cornelius family, Cornelius Campbell's family. And what happened was that the little boy got into some poison and died. So it was unfortunate that happened. So when Chief Shakora came back, he found out about that. And he went after the Campbell family, and he did nasty things to them. He killed the whole family except for Cornelius. So Cornelius was he was the family, he was the father of the family, so he got in touch, he found out about Shakora and chased him up the mountain, which we know today is Mount Shakora. So, okay, I gotta go to one more slide here. And when he came back, he found that his son was killed by the thing that he was chased up the mountain, that mountain there with, let's see if I got the right one coming up. Okay, that's the one I want. Story right there. Okay, this is a sort of an illustration that took place up there. That's Cornelius over there. He chased Chief Shakora up to the top of this rock that's on top of the mountain. You can still see that rock from different parts of the trail. It's a big, huge boulder just sits out there. And legend says that he jumped off that rock, but before he jumped off, he put a curse on the valley and said that all the crops would die and the animals would die and stuff like that. And it was just a legend. So it really, you know, things did happen, but they really can't say it was his curse that did it. There are more information about it, and I'll cover that in the books tonight that I usually use for reference. So we're going to move on, and we're going to see a lot of history, other history ideas, other history things that took place in the White Mountains. I have been on top of Mount Washington, and I have seen the ocean from the top of Mount Washington. That's how they saw Mount Washington, is from the ocean, as you can see. He sold part of the coastline to New Hampshire to the colonists. Chief Passaconway, there's a mountain named after him, Mount Passaconway, which is in the Sandwich Range. Legend. Thank you. Timothy Nash actually discovered Crawford Notch, and it was named after Ethan Allen Crawford. And he, today, the trail at Crawford Path is the oldest maintained trail in the United States, still held today, still maintained. And it's picked up at Crawford Notch and it goes to the summit of Mount Washington. The Indians worship the Old Man of the Mountain as a great stone face, or that's when the article, the story came out, but the Indians actually looked at it as the gods. Ooh, we're having a little trouble with our little DVD play here tonight. Yeah, that's the first path to Mount Washington. It was done by Abel and Alan Crawford, and it's still maintained today. It's the oldest path in the United States, still maintained. It's a nice trail, too. It goes right up over Eisenhower, Pierce, and Monroe, and right to the summit of Mount Washington. We'll talk a little bit more about the Willie family and how they perished in a landslide. The White Mountains are mostly all formed by glaciers years and years and years ago before our time. Before my time, too. The Dollycop Campground is up in Glen, New Hampshire, and it was named after Hayes and Dolly Cop Inn up there, and they lived there for many years, and they were sort of like a nice farm family that took care of people as they passed through. They had their own little hotel and everything, a motel, whatever they wanted to call it, but they took care of the settlers that came through the notch. Lizzie Borden was the first to perish on Mount Washington. It's not the Lizzie Borden we know that, you know, it's a different Lizzie Borden. She wasn't two places at once. Yeah. She was actually less than 50 feet away from the summit of the mountain when she perished in a snowstorm. Carriage Road now is called the Auto Road. And it was carriages, horse-drawn carriages, that actually went to the summit of Mount Washington. This is a sunset shot taken at Lakes of the Clouds, just on the west side of Mount Washington. There's a ravine named after Huntington. It's Huntington's Ravine. It's where the ice climbers go in the wintertime. It's you've got Tuckerman Ravine and Huntington's Ravine. They're both on the east side of Mount Washington, if you're familiar with Mount Washington. Okay, now we're going to talk about this guy here. Okay, Darby Field became the first white man to climb Mount Washington, and he went up by way of the Crawford Path, which we know today. It wasn't the Crawford Path then, it was well before it was built. He went up with two of the Abenaki Indians. And they were their guide. So they got up to just up to where the tree line was, and the Indians stayed behind because they feared the gods at the top of Mount Washington, which is a big, huge mountain at that time, and the Indians looked at it as a place not to go to. But Darby Field went up there, and he went up there to look for treasures and also for a pathway to Canada. And he went up several times, but he was the first white man to climb Mount Washington. And there's several things named after Darby Field. Darby Field Inn, which is on 16, you probably saw the sign for it. And it's also Mount Field, which is named after Darby Field as well. And he's got a number of other things up there. He actually came originally from from Exeter, New Hampshire. That's where he originally came from. Okay, there's Mount Field, that's in Crawford Notch, right opposite Jackson. It's got that face on front of it with the rocks and everything. I've been up on Field, that's a 4,000 footer, by the way. And this is the sign that talks about it. You can find that on Route 16, that same sign as you talked about the him going up there. The first railroad that passed through there is still there today. In fact, it's not in the wintertime, but in the summertime, They have trips that come out of Conway, North Conway, that go up through there. There's one, it's a dining, what do they call it? It's a dining, dining train, where they have dinner on it and everything. It stops at the train station in Crofton. I joined the day, I joined the year after it started. If that was the case, I'd be in deep trouble. Doctors would wonder why I'm still around. Yeah, there was a publication on top of Mount Washington, Among the Clouds, and it's in the Historical Society. They have a museum up there that shows about the Among the Clouds. Hey, darling. Hayes and Dolly Kopp, they leave the farm, and she decided to go back down to Massachusetts, and he went over to Maine. And she stated that after 50 years with the same guy, it's about time we break up. This is another one of the profiles in the White Mountains. In fact, we'll see it later on, and someone will talk about it. It's actually George Washington lying in state. If you look at it, you'll see his nose. But we'll cover across it again, and I'll make mention to it. That ascended the top of Mount Washington was a Stanley steamer. It's still in the museum over at the Glen, over by the Auto Road. You can go in there and see it's in the restaurant. This is some of my winter hiking. That was like 3 feet of snow there, through snow, going through with snowshoes and everything. You can actually tell where those acres were. You can see where the fire was. If you look down, you can see that the trees weren't as old. They're kind of relatively new trees. And there's our little friend, the winter bird. You only see about 3,000 feet up. It's called the gray jay, and they're scroungers. They come around looking for hikers with crumbs. The story about the Willie House. Okay. Get this into the next slide, and we'll talk about that. Okay. The Willie House is in Crawford Nosh. How many have been up by the Willie House? Have seen the museum? Okay, then you know where it is. What was happening was the Willie family moved in. The house is still there, I believe. It's further up into the woods, or it's right around there. And that's sort of like an illustration of it. It was a summer, and we had a bad drought up there, and it was no rain at all. So finally they had this big downpour of rain, torrential rains, and all the ground just loosened up, and there was an avalanche coming off of Willie Mountain. Mount Willie at that time was named an Indian name. And it came down, so the family ran from the house to the barn to be safe with their hired hands and their family, their kids and all. And unfortunately, they were buried and they perished in the barn. However, the house was never touched. The reason being is just in line with the house was a big boulder. And when the avalanche came down, the stuff went around the boulder and protected the house. So the deal is, there's a landslide, stay home. But that's the story about the Willie family. And you can see their museum. It's up there in Crawford Notch on 302. It's quite interesting. They have a very, very good museum up there. That's all in Crawford Notch. It's a lot of historical stuff up in the White Mountains. The Appalachian Mountain Guide is one of the best guides I've seen in the White Mountains. It really, really covers a lot of information about the trails. The maps are cover a lot of information, and it's worth getting the book if you're going to do a lot of hiking, because they do set up a lot of good information in there. The winters are just so nice up there. Usually my pictures in the winter are taken right after big snowstorm, so the sky is blue and the snow is all powdery, and it's cold and it's nice. I like the cold weather. I should have been an Eskimo. I'll be going up there this winter and staying at the Carter Notch Hut. The Appalachian Mountain Club has 8 huts that are up in the White Mountains that you can stay. 3 are open in the winter, or year-round in the wintertime, and Carter Notch is one of them. There's no heat in there. You take your own food up, and you have to cook it in their kitchen and clean up after. And it's quite interesting. Lakes of the Clouds is one of their larger huts. They hold up to 92 people. In the summer day, it's all summer long, it's never empty. It's always full. That's Madison's the Madison Spring Hut. Washington is south of that, on the other side of the peak. We do have that. That's in my other part of the show tonight. We'll talk about the huts and stuff. First time I climbed out of Washington was in 1975, and they still had the old wooden building up there. Have you ever seen the old wooden building? The new Sherman Observatory was not there at that time. And you had to walk in this rickety old building, which was a hotel they tore down. And it's quite nice to see that place. But, not anymore. That's the Lafayette Ridge in the back, or Franconia Ridge in the back of Lafayette and Liberty and Lincoln. I hope you enjoyed this part of the show. History of the White Mountains. We're going through the seasons of the White Mountains now. I get my information from these two books mainly. I'll let you see them. They're not for sale, but I'll just show you what they are. This gentleman here, John T. Mudge, he's a local historian up in the White Mountains, and he's done a number of books. And this one really covers a lot of information about the history of the White Mountains in a small form. And this was another one. It was put by Lucy, the wife of Ethan Allen Crawford, and she writes up a really good story also about the White Mountains, too. So these are my two favorite. I have a number of books that I do my street yard research on, but these are my two favorite. They come out with a lot of information, so I'll leave them here. You can glance at them. They are available, I think they're both available at Barnes & Noble if anybody's interested in them. I think it was my disc that was making all a little scratchy like that because I use them a lot. I'm producing a new one right now. It's going to have a little more information, but that's not until next year. Okay, this is going to be the seasons of the White Mountains, and I'll cover some of the information as we go along, the different mountains and where I was and what trails I was on and what time of the year. Like I said, this is the most photographed and painted mountain in New England, or in New England itself, is Mount Shikora. Darby Field says that that's the Alps, one of the Alps of the White Mountains. Years ago, the White Mountains were actually as tall as the Alps in Switzerland and in Austria, but over the years they wore down. But that was way back when. There's a book out, it's called The Alps of the White Mountains, or The Mountains, White Mountains of the Alps. It's quite an interesting book. There we go, we're looking at Shikora, my favorite mountain. Over the years, I've been hiking with people, and a lot of times some of the young ones like to go real fast, but once they go with me and I like to stop and take pictures, they don't usually like to go with me anymore. They said, we're gonna go way ahead of you, okay? I like to stop and take pictures. This is actually, the trail goes right through here, going up to Mount Eisenhower, right across this ice. So you have to walk on the ice on it. It is Mount Washington in the spring. Actually, that's in the springtime. That mountain can get snow 12 months out of the year. They already got a dusting up there. They had dusting in the end of August. They had dusting snow up there. This is how the huts get their food. These are members of the Appalachian Mountain Club that carry the food up on these big, huge backpacks. They're racks. I don't know if you've ever seen them on the trail, but they actually climb up there with all that stuff on their back, and they provide the food for the people staying in the huts. It's all young kids, probably about 18 and 19, but you wouldn't catch me carrying one. When I was younger, I used to come off the trail and get to the bottom and put my feet into the water. So it was nice and cold, felt good. That's Flume Mountain. That's located right at the actual flume itself is at the base of that mountain. And that slide that you saw is where the water comes down and caught. It created the flume. Have you ever been to the flume in the... And, okay, that's in Franconia Notch. That's where that took place. There's Pinkham Lodge Base Camp. You can see it in the bottom of the picture. And that's Huntington's Ravine right there and Tuckerman's Ravine. I found this on the trail. I thought it was pretty nice. Somebody had stuck a rock in the green stuff and shaped like a heart. So I made a card and gave it to my daughter for Valentine's Day when she thought it was kind of cool. The Avalon Trail is quite popular up there. It covers several mountains. And the AZ stands for Avalon Zealand. There's two mountains that the trail goes between. You ever go up Mount Jefferson, that's the Caps going up to the top of Mount Jefferson, the Caps Trail, which is... I found that Mount Washington was easier to climb than Jefferson. Jefferson's the second highest mountain up there. That's Mount Monroe. Mount Lafayette was named after a French general Lafayette, who came and spent some time with the colonists years ago in the White Mountains. You'll see a lot of trail signs. I just love taking pictures of trail signs. They don't smile, but I take the picture. Yeah, they're just beautiful stuff up in the White Mountains. It's just gorgeous up there. I've been climbing the mountain since I was 16, and I still can't get enough of it. That's part of the trail on Mount Mootsalak, and that pile of rocks is what they call a cairn. It's a way of marking the trail in bad weather. They used them a lot in Austria and Switzerland, so they were brought into this country when the settlers came over and do the same thing. This is a sunset at Lakes of the Clouds in August. That was beautiful. Ridge way in the back, the furthest one out is Lafayette. The ridge comes all the way across. I've done the ridge. It's 4 miles long from Lafayette to Liberty and back. It's actually 5 miles if you go to Flumont, but I only went as far as Liberty. Those I'm not sure what they call them.
Mountain
Edge. Oh, is that what it is?
Yeah.
Mountain Edge.
That's Cannon Mountain up there in the back. This is the trail going up to Cannon Mountain. It's the High Cannon Trail. Oh, actually, it's Lonesome Lake Trail. It goes up and meets up with the top mount Cannon Mountain. You look dead straight in the center here. You see by somebody's face with a beard and mustache? That's my son. We were climbing Mount Washington at that time. That was in August. There was still snow and ice in the trail in the ravine. It's Mount Welch. Mount Welch and Dickey are right in Waterville Valley. They're a beautiful hike to do. It's a loop trail. It's about 2 or 3 miles long. I don't know if anybody's ever done the Welch Dickey. That's really a nice trail. I've done it year round. You know that spot that's kind of steep? That was all ice. When I did it, it was fun. bogs outside of Lonesome Lake. You can walk there at night, it's beautiful. The scenery I talked about being the George Washington lion in state, his forehead, his nose, and his chin. That is one of the profiles up there. There's Elephant Rock, that's another profile. There's actually an old lady mountain, but you have to go up the Greenleaf Trail to see that one. You have to go about a mile and a half, and it's on the side of Eagle Cliff. But the only way you can see is from the trail. She actually looks over where the old man in the mountain was years ago, when he was around. When something wants to grow, the rocks will be there, but it'll still grow. The tree decided to grow on the rocks. Mount Washington. Now we got Monroe in the foreground. This is actually Pierce Monroe, Mount Washington. That's the cograil. Take a good picture of that. Look at that, because they no longer have the black coal trains up there. They're all biofuel now, which is better for the environment. They still make the same noise and everything.
It's harder to see it though.
Yeah, it's true. But these guys decided to play Ring Around the Rosie, so I took a picture of them all in a circle. And this is one of the reasons why I like climbing in the wintertime, because usually there's 4 feet of snow on all those rocks, and it's nice and smooth. In the wintertime, I usually start my hike about 5 o'clock in the morning. Because of the short daylight time, you don't have much time to go up and down a 4 mile trail. So you're usually coming down in the dark, for the most part. But I'm equipped for that, so. It's one of the other huts, that's the Greenleaf Hut. That's on the side of Mount Lafayette, and that's Cannon Mountain across the way. You probably noticed the ski trails. This is Echinacea. Probably saw them around a lot.
Okay.
Yeah, Echinacea's good. I have the tea myself. I like the Echinacea tea. That's at Lonesome Lake. That's actually one of the cannonballs. There's three round-shaped mountains that sit to the west of Mount Cannon Mountain, and they call them the cannonballs. It's part of the Kinsman Trail. That's a beautiful lake there too. I think that's part of Shakora Lake. Now there's my son. We decided to climb Mount Lafayette. That pointed part up here in the rocks, that's actually that nose that I pointed out of Lafayette. Of Liberty. That's Bootsburg Trail that goes up over these ridges and comes down. It's the side of Mount Washington. There's Mount Lafayette. There you go.
I got to there.
Yeah. Usually a lot of people go up Fallen Waters, go across the ridge and down Lafayette on the Greenleaf Trail. It makes a nice loop because you come back to the same spot in the parking lot. That's Lakes of the Clouds. That's another one. That's the large hut. That's the largest one that tails up to 92 people. You know, hot summer day, that place is pretty nice. A little raw, but nice. Mount Adams. There are actually three mountains in that range. The Adams family, they call them. John Quincy Adams, Sam Adams, and I can't remember the other Adams, but there was three of them in a row. What's that?
Just John Adams.
That's right, Adams. Lakes of the Clouds. There's actually two lakes there. That's my son. We're going over to spend the night there.
Is there a loop trail around there?
Around the lakes?
Around from that hut that goes around?
Yes. See, that's the top of Mount Washington. That's when we're just before sunset. son's out there reading the book, and I'm taking pictures. That night, the moon was so bright that you could walk around outside at 10 o'clock at night without a flashlight. It's like daylight up there. So I said to my son, I goes, why don't we just get a little nap and get up around 10 o'clock and go up Mount Monroe and come back down. So, we were so tired, we fell asleep. And the next thing you know, we heard the banging of the pans for breakfast. Slept right through. This is one of the hostels up here in the White Mountains, up next to Highland Center. It's a hut where people can stay. They're coming through camping. They want to stay there. That's part of the AT to the Appalachian Trail. It was right by that way, so they have a tendency to stay there overnight to rest. Last year, not this past year, but last year's fall was beautiful up there. Just gorgeous pictures. This is the about 2 years ago, and I took these. And the colors were okay, but not like it was 2 years ago. I mean, not this year, last year. Beautiful. That's one of the ski trails off of Cannon Mountain looking down. That's my postcard picture. In the fall, taking out fishing for probably the last time. I've met people from Austria and Switzerland and Germany over there in the White Mountains in fall because they don't have the same colors we have. And they come over here and they see them. They say it's unbelievable. And there's a nice bright orange tree. Sugarloaf is on 302 around Brenton Woods in that area. It's a small mountain. It's at least 2,600 feet, but it's a nice little hike. It's a really nice one. What I like about it is it's lower than the big ones around you, so you're sort of like sitting on like a chair looking at all the mountains around you. Beautiful. There's that profile again. We have so many different trees up in the White Mountains. Unbelievable what colors we get. A very good variety.
Longhorn beetles making their way up there?
What's that?
Are the beetles making their way up there?
I haven't seen any of them or heard of them at this time. And usually I get information from the Appalachian Mountain Club because they usually take note to that and let hikers know. Yeah, I hope not either. How'd they get into the country? They came in through after imports or something? Or somebody got them in here? That's the Mount Washington Hotel. And that's the car rail right in the back. You see the train track going up. How many been on the car rail? Anybody on the car rail? Yeah, isn't it something, huh?
I think they're still running once a day, the old trains, though.
I think one is just still running, but most of them are all the biodiesel.
Yeah, 2 years ago they switched, but
yeah.
I think it's one a day.
I think it's a good idea. It's not as... I mean, I was on Mount Eisenhower, which is south of Mount Washington in Crawford Notch, and I could actually smell the smoke coming on a windy day. I also could smell the food being cooked over at Lakes of the Clouds, and that was like 9 miles away, but you could still, it was coming in, and I was unbelievable. I asked, what's that? Somebody's cooking it, it's the hut. I looked at the clock, 4:30, they're making the bread. I like my cloud formations. I call that my eagle flying. That one could be an angel too. Okay, get on your overcoats. Now we're going to go into the winter. This is the trail going up to Mount Willard. And this is what you see from the top of Mount Willard. It's only 2,800 feet, it's a mile and a half up. It's a gorgeous hike if you're up in there. It's by the train station in Crawford Notch. This is actually what the color looked like when I took the picture at sunrise. That's Mount Jackson there. That's from Mount Willard. And I got some moose tracks. That's about all. I've never really seen a moose in the winter, or even on the trail. I've only seen a remnants of a moose.
I'm sure that's a lot.
What's that?
I'm sure that's a lot.
Oh, yeah. Now watch where you're walking the trail.
Do you see coyotes or wolves?
I've not seen any wildlife at all. I've just seen chipmunks and squirrels. I saw a possum, not a possum, but a mink one time, and I see these gray jays. They'll land in your hand if you do this. If you got crumbs in your hand, they'll land them, but you're not supposed to do that. This is where they do all the skiing in Tuckerman Ravine. You talk about the spring skiing. That's them skiing right there. I was up there one time, kids, 14 years old, 13 years old, going up and taking the snowboards up and coming down. Unbelievable. This is right after a snowstorm. Isn't that chilly? It was like 12 degrees that day when I was going up to Jackson.
So they have to walk back up that ravine, right?
Yes, they have to walk up and then ski down. I met some people last spring. Actually, it was in the wintertime. The ravine was closed because of avalanche, but they were skiing down the Sherbin Trail. And it took them about 2.5 hours to get up there, but it took them 20 minutes to get down. So I met this one guy going up for the second time. He goes, boy, you are a deadhead, die hard.
You were right the first time.
Under the railroad, too, now.
What's that?
Right,
the Cograil takes you up a ways up, and you can ski down, which is good. They were going to do it all the way to the summit. And it decided, not a good idea. Okay, here's Liberty. This is Liberty looking at Lafayette. That was right after a major snowstorm the next day. And this little guy was watching me climb the trail. He says, you got any food for me? No, it's a gray jay. There's Mount Cannon Mountain. Over there, that white spot over to the left, that's Lonesome Lake. And this is what I like about the trails in the wintertime. If it's kind of steep, you got some pair of nylon pants on, you can slide right down.
Yeah.
Watch out for these trees, because they jump out in front of you. Actually, I got one of these things that looks like a thing you can sit on, hold on to, and sit down and slide down. I have not yet done it, but I plan to.
So you need a snowshoes?
I use snowshoes for the most part, but if it's packed down snow, I use crampons. Which are made for that kind of stuff.
Yes.
The ice is packed out of snow, yes. And that's going up to Mount Washington, but I didn't climb it, I just went up as far as the ravine, but that's a beautiful trail. And that's Cathedral Ledge in North Conway.
Sure is.
Right out, right, sunset. That's the Franconia Ridge from Lonesome Lake. This is the Jim Liberty Cabin. I've spent a number of times in the summertime with my brothers. And that's Tuckerman Ravine. And there's another part of the trail going up to Tuckerman Ravine. And you've got Lion's Head over to the right. And that's the show.
The motto to that is you can't have pictures if you don't do the climb.
That's right. That's right, because a lot of people don't want to climb, but I'll take climb. I'll take any questions about photography or where I've been on these trails. And if you have any questions, I'll be glad to take that.
What's the AMC book that you recommended?
It's the White Mountain Guide.
Okay.
It covers all the presidential range, all the notches, and it has a very good detail about the trails. So when you read it, you've got an idea of what you're up against. It tells you how difficult it is, and if it's a winter trail, they usually kind of tell you to make sure you're prepared for the winter.
And it comes with maps.
It comes with gorgeous maps. They just did them over about 3 years ago using a GPS. The old ones and the new ones, you could see how the trail was really somewhat off from some of them. And then some of the trails would change that get confused too. You go in a certain way and all of a sudden you think, oh, wait a minute, they changed the trail on me.
Do you ever hike alone?
The only time I hike alone is when I go on mountains that are well-populated, but most cases I go with groups.
Yeah.
I was trained with the Appalachian Mountain Club for winter hiking. I took their course, so I know what I'm up against, and I had a lot of the knowledge with Boy Scouts and stuff. I don't use GPSs, I use maps and compass. That's the only way I get around the mountains. People with GPSs, the battery could go dead. But I like sticking with the old way. The maps and the compass are the best way to get around if you know how to read them. So, yep. And there's a lot of nice trails, small trails up there too, that are really, really nice to venture out on, give you a lot of information, a lot of fun to see. You don't have to be all the big stuff. You can do the small stuff too as well. So.
Do you really have to worry about ticks, or where you're not stepping in tall?
Well, most trails are pretty wide, so you really won't see the grassy areas that will get you. But there are trails that come narrow, and there are some grass that you just have to watch it. I hike with poles, so I kind of knock a lot of stuff out of the way, things these hiking poles people have. They kind of knock the stuff out of the way, and you don't have that much of a problem. I've only got ticks on me last year, 3 that I was at home. In the mountains, they get nothing. But, yeah, and you just get prepared to hike the White Mountains. You make sure you get a good pair of boots. That's the most important part. And there's a lot of small stuff that if you go along the sides of the roads, like the King Mangus, you can stop and see a lot of historical stuff. There's a house there. It's an old house in, I think it's in Albany, New Hampshire. It's on the King Mangus Highway. And you stop in, there's a lady in there, and she's dressed with the time era. And she'll go through and tell you all about it if you've ever stopped there or not. It's really a nice nice place. I've stopped a number of times there.
It's somewhere near the bridge?
It's not too far from the bridge. It's almost halfway on the highway. Mm-hmm. You'll see, you can't miss it. It's an old house, a farmhouse on the right-hand side. And it's really interesting. It's a museum inside. You can go through and take a look at how people lived. And they talk about the family that was there, too. I come across a lot of old foundations on the trails that are up about 2,000 or 3,000 feet up. And you say, how did they get up here? Old farmhouses. The foundations are still there, but nobody's around.
When you said the man was climbing to Mount Washington for treasure, I thought, who's going there to bury it?
Well, you never know. They could have been somebody, earlier settlers that came through there, some of the Native Indians or whatever. But that's what he was looking for.
Yeah.
They believe it was treasure, could have been anything, but that's one of the things that he said he couldn't find. So again, this book that I use is White Mountains, Names, Places, and Legends. It's by John T.B. Mudge. He does a really good write-up. It tells you all the information, talks about certain events that took place up there with the settlers and all. And then I said this other book is another nice one here by Lucy Allen Crawford. It's by Ethan Allen's wife who put this book together. It's another good that's really interesting, but I must have about 12, 13 books of the White Mountains, so I got an idea what they're talking about, different people. Yes?
Have you gotten caught in serious storms while you were hiking?
The only time I got into a situation where it was pretty bad was coming off of Lonesome Lake, which is Cannon Mountain. We were coming into a whiteout, so it was 5 of us in the group. We all had to stop and wait till the whiteout passed through, and it's coming right through the Franconia Notch. You're kind of like, took 20 minutes to go right through. It was a complete whiteout, and all of a sudden, it stopped. So we find our way down. And the trails were all marked in the wintertime. You can see them. If you open up the trails in the summertime, you often wonder, why is the marker up this far?
Yeah.
Because in the wintertime, it's down here. And it's pretty obvious, too. So, yes?
What's your favorite hike that incorporates the use of a cabin?
I'm going to want to say probably, one of the huts, you mean?
Yes.
I think Madison's my favorite. Mm-hmm. It's the Northern Presidentials. It's right between Adams and Madison. It sits there and there's Star Lakes there. It's a small little pond. It's a beautiful setting. And it's about 4 miles up, and there's a number of different trails. If you go up there and see the trails, there's a number of different ones that were formed going up there. And I went up there to stay at Madison Hut one time because I wanted to do some photography. And I went up with my son. We got up to trailhead, and there was no place to park. There was cars all over the place. I says, there can't be something special going. So we went back down to Pinkham Notch, and they bust us up there because they'll do that for free, you know, just bust you up there, and then they come and get you the next day. So we're halfway up the trail, and people starting to come down and coming down. I said, what's going on? I said, what was so important up there? So some people got married up there. And here comes the bride and the groom with backpacks on, says, just married, you know. And then the mother of the bride, the father of the bride, and all that stuff. I met them all coming down. There must have been about 30 or 40 people up there for the ceremony. And that's where you headed now. Well, we're going down to some nice inn down in Jefferson for the dinner reception after. So I said, wow, that's interesting. But anyways, but that's a nice one. It's one of my favorites, a northern one, and it's kind of isolated, so at night you can really see a good star show because there's not too many lights up in that area. Yeah. So
now you have to reserve.
All the huts, you have to do reservations in advance. Yeah. Sometimes they'll take them as you come in, but it's very rare that that happens. For me to stay at Lakes of the Clouds, which is the most popular one, I had to put a year in advance.
Wow.
Because of it's so popular. It was a full camp that night, a full hut, which is 92 people. And they set up all these tables with benches, and they set up all the meals for you. So you get to have two meals plus a place to stay. You don't have to have a tent. They have bunks all over there. You can just take a bunk, and they're usually three or four high in the huts. You got one on the bottom, then another one up here, another one up here. They used to have one up four, and it took all the fours up because too many people were falling and hurting themselves. It's way up there. That's quite a ways up. But my son and I always used to like to get the bottom ones on the floor so you could just lie on the floor and just drop into the bed so you don't have to worry about climbing up. And, you know, it was fun. So, yeah, I stayed at Greenleaf twice. And I've stayed at Madison twice, Lonesome Lake a number of times. But they're really nice huts. All of them are really nice to stay in. And they're a day apart. So if you want to do the hut jumps, you can go from one hut to another within a day. They're designed that way. Yes?
Well, the problem with that is you're making those reservations ahead.
Yes.
You don't know what the weather is going to be.
That's
so
true,
you
too.
You need to really have some preparation.
That's true, too. You have to make sure. What I usually do is when I'm going to do any kind of serious hiking, like Mount Washington, I look at the almanac, I look how the weather has been in the last couple summers and kind of plan around it. I think it was only one time, the second time I climbed Mount Washington, it was in the fog. Other than that, every time I climbed, it was in bright sunlight. It was beautiful. Wow. I was up there one morning so early, I could look out and I could see the actual ocean. You could see the ocean out there.
That's luck.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
But it only lasted about 20 minutes. Okay, so now we're going to ask that word again, see if you know what it is. And I have mentioned it a number of times in this presentation. Angiokookachuk. It's the Indian name for Mount Washington. So if anybody asks, it's the Indian name. The Indians gave that name. In fact, they looked at the whole mountain, the whole range, the whole presidential range was one big mountain. It wasn't just Mount Washington. The whole mountain was massive, and they just treated it as the gods. So it's Angiokookachuk. Yep. So that's what it is. So now you can always go home and say, hey, I know what Mount Washington was called before. Mount Washington.
Yeah. I'm not going to remember it to the bottom of my mind. Any other
questions out there? Yes.
Did you please tell me what type of camera you use for your
photography? Oh, that's what I was getting to. I use a Canon. I use Canon equipment. I've done Canon equipment all the way since the film days. And I'm using a Canon 40D. And I have two lenses with it. I have Sigma lenses, which is 17 to 70 millimeter. If you're familiar with f-stops, it's an f2.8, which is a very large opening. The larger the opening, the better the light is and the better the picture is. And that's 17 to 70 millimeter. And then I have a 70 to 300 millimeter lens at a f4.5. They all go with me when I'm up in these mountains. They're right in the holster right here. They usually let the big lenses in the back. In most cases, I'm using the smaller lens. And if I go up in the mountains in the wintertime, it's got to sleep with me inside my sleeping bag. So that's why I get a large sleeping bag, so I can put all my electronic stuff in. So it won't get freeze.
That's true. So it's no digital?
Yes, it is a digital. The 40D is a digital camera. It's actually an alloy body. It's a metal body as opposed to the... If you've got Canons, they have the EOS bodies, the Rebel bodies. Those are the composite. They're like a plastic body. They look metal, but they're plastic. They're much lighter than the 40D. The 40D is kind of heavy. So, but I still have it right inside of me. I'm climbing all the time, taking pictures. It's a good camera. So, I mean, Nikon's got their version of it, and there's Canon too. But I'm kind of a partial to here. And I use Photoshop to do all my editing, which is a really good program.
Any other questions? I don't want to cut things off. It's been a lot of fun. Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, you're welcome. The next time I'll be in the area will be January.